El modelo para la conformación del Área de Libre Comercio de las Américas proviene del Tratado de Libre Comercio de América del Norte, el famoso NAFTA inglés o TLCA en español.
El ALCA fue lanzado en 1994.
Desde Alaska hasta Tierra del Fuego.
En la primera cumbre de las Américas.
¡Proceso contra el ALCA!
No al ALCA.
Resistencia
contra el ALCA. Expreso rechazo al ALCA. Difundirlo y denunciarlo, buscando la brecha, haciendo lo que dé lugar que no haría falta.
Preservar las aguas de los ríos de la lógica del lucro. No al ALCA. No a la OMC. No al Imperio Norteamericano.
Resistencia.
Interrumpir las negociaciones. Bloqueo de rutas de acceso a la ciudad.
No al ALCA. La OMC, no al Imperio Norteamericano.
Interrumpir las negociaciones. Bloqueo de rutas de acceso a la ciudad.
El ALCA.
Lo que permite consolidar la presencia del capital transnacional en particular.
I think we have a model here for the rest of the world to really emulate for the future when they have these sort of events take place.
Bloqueo de rutas de acceso a la ciudad de Miami del 17 al 21 de noviembre.
They didn't want people seeing the poverty here. They only wanted to show the glamour and the glitz. But I mean, that's just not the way Miami is. Most people don't know Miami's glamour and glitz. Miami is a very bizarre city, not only because of its economic situation, which is the poorest big city in the United States, but also because of the cultural and ethnic mix. In the black community, there is even a further division, which is African American and large number of Haitians. 84, I believe, a young kid, Neville Johnson, was playing hooky from school. He was in an arcade playing a video game, and a cop walked up to him, asked him why he wasn't in school, and before he could answer, shot him in the head. Arthur McDuffie was an insurance salesman, black, living in Miami. In 1979, went out for a motorcycle ride and was being chased by the police. And at some point, he tried to turn onto the highway, and the wheels came out from under him, and he skidded to a halt. Then the cops who came surrounded him and with their batons and things literally beat him to death. Took off his helmet, in fact, and beat him to death with his helmet off. And then after he was beaten to death, they put his helmet back on, called the ambulance, and said that he died from his injuries from the fall of the motorcycle. The case went to trial, and of course, all the cops were acquitted. In 1980, Miami cop was standing on the street, saw kids riding on a moped, told them to stop. When they didn't stop, shot them point blank range as they were driving by. So this is Carl Williams' house, and he was shot dead by Miami-Dade police during a weed and seed sweep. And it freaked a lot of people out. Which really made the tie that whether you were black and from Haiti or black and from more in the United States, you were still a target of the police. And that created a level of unity, although based on a negative, which had not been seen in a while. And then the stepped up campaign against Haitian refugees has actually worked to increase the level of unity among African Americans and Haitians. And African Americans even were able to see that this was unfair treatment, which was racially based, and therefore were able to identify with it. All right, so Overtown is just north and west of downtown Miami. And now as they're trying to expand downtown Miami, they have to go to Overtown, even though people have avoided it for many, many years because it's been seen as the black community. In the 60s, there were about 40, 45,000 people living in Overtown. Today, in 2003, 2004, there's about 10,000 people. So the numbers have really been depleted. As a result, a lot of the businesses here have gone out of business. The city of Miami has on its own shut down and demolished 350 units of public housing. This corner right here used to have a big apartment complex in it there. It was bad housing, there's no doubt about that. I'm not arguing it was good housing, but it was housing. And there was approximately 50 families there. Now it's all gone, and that's been an empty lot for the past several years. Empty lots are not helping either with housing or economic development. So about 15 years ago, they built a publicly funded arena for the basketball team, Miami Heat. It was called the Miami Arena. Spent a lot of money on it, and then wrote in guarantees, in a real sweetheart deal, that if for whatever reason the basketball team could not pay for the arena, the city would pick up all the costs. 10 years later, the basketball team said, we want another stadium, even though they haven't finished paying off the first one. And because they were going to another one, that meant that the city would have to pick up, the taxpayers had to pick up the cost for every single non-payment made to the Miami Arena. And then in between the two are all these homeless people who could be using the money that's being spent on both of these arenas to get food, clothing, and shelter. It's really, really a crime. And the money is just like going over them, but it's not coming down to them. And of course, the way they convince people to get it is that they say that this is gonna solve homelessness and solve the economic crisis in the communities where they're built. All through here, where you see the colors and the fenced up areas, was a massive squatting, just a public squatting area. People would live here. They would just have their knapsacks and their whatever else they had and would live through here. And they closed it all up for the first Summit of the Americas meeting, which laid the groundwork for the FTAA. Miami officials did not want heads of state and high officials from other countries to come in and see all the homeless people living here under these in these conditions. So they kicked everyone off, cut down the high grass and everything, and fixed it up and painted these pillars so that people wouldn't know that there were homeless people living here. And they must have dispossessed 3,000, maybe 4,000 people from the only land that they had. And that was it. That was the beginning of the FTAA.
Ladies and gentlemen, the governor of Florida and a true friend of the Americas, Jeb Bush.
We welcome you to this important ministerial where the Americas Business Forum has a chance to impact policy for the next generation of time in a region of 800 million people. Florida is a place where dreams come true. And my dream for our state is that we take full advantage of our geography and the incredible 16 million people that live here who come from every nook and cranny of the world. Heck, it's more diverse than Baskin-Robbins' number of ice cream flavors that you can have. The dreams and hopes of the countries of Alca will also benefit from tearing down barriers and recognizing at the end of the day we're all brothers and sisters. Dios los bendiga.
Supply truck to be ready to go. Then we're gonna have a little meeting and breakfast.
We'd like to thank you all for coming from all across the country to be here, to be in solidarity with the workers and other grassroots organizations, and to be a part of history.
Different groups of people, African Americans, immigrant farm workers, and then even smaller groupings of Haitian immigrants. We found that there are a lot of things that we have in common.
It's tiempo. De estar como estamos hoy. Todas las razas, diferentes caminos de la vida, estudiantes, trabajadores, pero todos juntos para decir no a la injusticia.
I see root cause as starting formally because of the FTA coming to Miami, but in reality, this has been a long time coming.
We had to fight with the whole six. They retained on 850 housing for low income and they wanted to build like 80, they're gonna privatize everything. And when they privatize it, it's not gonna be for the low income families.
Generally what's happening is the housing agency and HUD is getting out of the business of public housing. They don't wanna house people anymore. And what they're really interested in is using whatever federal dollars they can to leverage private development of affordable housing, which usually is something that people who make $50,000 to $80,000 a year can afford. That's what they consider affordable. But the majority of the people who live here make $10,000 to $15,000 a year.
The environmental impacts, is the work that Power U does around the effects of the environment on young people, on old people, just on our living conditions. The corporations that they don't just pollute here, they set up camp in our neighborhoods.
You know, you hear a lot about lead poisoning and mercury and stuff like that. If you lived there and you see all the different stuff there, you wouldn't believe it. Would you? I don't even think you would want to stay there, but people stay there because that's all they can afford.
Treasures of righteousness is love.
Bueno, aquí en Immokalee es, en este momento se gana casi el mismo sueldo que se ganaba hace como en 1980. Esto es 40, 45 centavos por cubeta. Piscar una cubeta a ese precio representa que para ganar $50 tienes que piscar 2 toneladas. Libre comercio beneficia nada más a los que tienen poder y los que tienen influencia en la política o en la economía de los diferentes países, pero afecta a todos. Estamos en una lucha local aquí en Immokalee, pero también conectados con la lucha global, buscando justicia global.
Neighborhoods, not commercial districts, were going around and people were standing outside gawking at all the protesters, handing out flyers and saying a few brief words about the FTAA. And that's one of the things our people do anyways. We do outreach on our issues.
What do you think about what's going on?
It's cool. Keep it up. It's good. I'm all for it. Justice for all, right?
Lo significante de esta marcha es que somos las organizaciones de base de los meros trabajadores que estamos organizando esto.
In the global justice movement, as it's evolved over the past few years, there's been a lack of a clear presence of community-based organizations and community-based interests.
Organizations of color who couldn't bring to the table a ton of money or a ton of people, but yet most of this impact that was going to happen here in South Florida around FTAA was going to be in our communities.
If we don't raise our own voices, they just might not be anyone to raise it for us.
No justice!
No peace!
No justice!
No peace!
No justice!
No peace!
No justice! No
mile journey, each step is important, so we made it this far, but I know we got to go on to Miami, another, what, 20 plus miles, but we had to get here first, we got to Miami. And it may win temporarily, but it's going to be defeated. Same way he had a temporary victory in Iraq, he get his behind whooped now, same thing happened here too, because they be said, up what the people say down with the FTAA.
Zapata vive, vive!
La lucha sigue, sigue!
Zapata vive, vive!
The man train up region!
In different corners of the world, like, people are gaining conscience and like, getting together to fight against this big monster, and they can't bring us down.
These are the violent protests often accompanying free trade talks that Miami has been preparing for. Tonight, Hank Tester takes you inside the anarchist world for some answers.
Anarchists putting their words into action. Small in numbers, yet their methods grab all the attention. Seattle, Montreal, Cancun, Miami, we are told, the next target.
Apparently some of you are naive enough or uninformed enough that you didn't notice what happened in Seattle, in Davos, Switzerland, in Cancun. Apparently you're asleep during some of these things. There are bad guys. And one of the emails I got here pointed out where they're planning simultaneous lockdowns, die-ins in each and every bank in the area. This is the nest of global capitalism. That nest is also the nest that happens to support our city financially. And I happen to own property in that nest of global capitalism, and I'm proud of it and will continue to do so.
Experienced a lot of harassment by police and curtailing of our ability to actually put on events such as the week of teachings that had been planned around mobilization. We set up an office at 217 North Miami Avenue, and starting about Tuesday, there was a massing of police outside the front doors off and on each day. For no apparent reason, they would just stand there. One evening, they put riot cops out in front, banged on the windows, poked out flyers, pointed at people inside, purely for intimidation purposes.
Well, we were just walking down here. We just got, we came into Miami yesterday, and we just walked, we're just coming down to check out the downtown area. And yes, all of these cops that you can see behind me just came up to us and told us to sit down. Were very aggressive in their manner. They said that there was a bomb threat and that we fit the description of the people that allegedly called in this supposed bomb threat. And then, just as quickly as they came in, they left. And I don't have any idea what happened.
Although they think that they silenced us, they have not silenced us because human spirit always comes out on top.
And are going to take things into our hands. Our voices are going to be heard, and we want a world that's good for us and our families and our communities.
We're
una causa justa, noble, y tiene el apoyo de la gente de Miami.
We expect to do exactly what we're doing. We expect to get downtown, look straight into the Intercontinental Hotel, and look eye to eye with the trade ministers and the people that will be there, and let them know that they can keep, try and keep us out, but we will not be excluded.
Yo creo que el momento más importante y también triste al mismo tiempo fue cuando llegamos al centro de Miami. Éramos trabajadores y estábamos movilizando a cerca de 3,000 policías que estaban alrededor de nosotros. Digo más emocionante e importante porque no era que estábamos llevando nuestro mensaje y estábamos llevándolo como nosotros quisimos, nosotros pusimos el tono. Pero es triste ver cómo en este país, cuando los trabajadores nos organizamos y salimos para defender nuestros derechos humanos, esto se pueda considerar como una de las amenazas más grandes a la seguridad nacional. Y se pregunta uno como en qué clase de mundo estamos viviendo. Como si ser pobre y salir a la calle y reclamar lo que uno merece es un como tan intimidante para el gobierno, entonces ¿dónde está la democracia?
And then they use every apparatus that they have in their disposition to keep us away from them.
We are saying that if we work, we have to be able to live in dignity.
Estoy diciendo que si uno trabaja, uno tiene que poder vivir con dignidad.
If we pick the tomatoes, our children have to be able to eat.
Si pisamos el tomate, nuestros niños deben de tener el derecho de comer.
And if we work to build this country, we need legal papers to allow us to live without fear and indignity.
Si vives y trabajas aquí, necesitamos los documentos para hacernos residentes y vivir en dignidad.
That is not too much to ask. So, we're gonna continue to fight these big corporations who want to rule our lives. We're gonna fight together.
Vamos a luchar juntos.
And then we're gonna win.
Y vamos a ganar.
Vamos a ganar.
La batalla. La batalla ensemble y la gagne. Vamos a luchar juntos y vamos a ganar.
Un aplauso. That is root cause, y'all.
No sé, yo creo que fue lo más bonito, el hecho de poder estar ahí cuando la amenaza o una amenaza tan grande para todo el continente estaba también y confrontarlo.
Free Carnival Area of the Americas was our effort to bring a vibrant and
engaging, colorful response to the effects of the FTAA. We also used it as a way to bring out the issues and the impacts of free trade, and especially to bring to light those issues into the media by using arts to engage the public.
I'm here with the Root Cause folks in solidarity with them. I helped provide the space, the warehouse in Lake Worth, to make the puppet.
Several months before the demonstrations in Miami, it was here in Lake Worth. We opened up a warehouse that was for the purpose of making puppets and other artwork for the protest. And it just became like a 24-hour puppet factory.
When the Root Cause March got to Miami, we got to actually perform the puppet show. The story was about how the world was before capitalism, basically, and how it's progressed into this thing that has just taken advantage of people and of the environment, and how these trade agreements are just further exploiting us. But in the end, we're gonna win out.
At this point right now, everything's locked down. I don't know what's going on, right? But I don't want this group to get involved in that. There's no reason for it, okay? You have communication with that group, right? Your communication is probably better than ours. Could you check with them and let me know what's going on?
We keep getting resistance and they don't tell us why they're holding us back. They don't tell us why they're blocking us. And except to say that they don't want the government center overwhelmed. Nobody here has any weapons. Nobody here has anything that can harm anybody. Nobody here has anything but their voice and their signs.
Well, we're doing the same thing we've been doing. It's kind of a frustration technique. They want to go a certain place, and we're saying, nah, we don't want you to go there.
Move to your left. Move to your left.
They told me to stay on the
side. Move to your left. They're trying to set up places to hurt us, guys. Be careful. They're putting things in the way.
How is that meant to hurt you?
When they say prepare the tasers, I mean, I see people out here with shirts. What does that mean?
Well, you know, tasers is one of our non-lethal forms of deterrent weaponry. We don't feel like we're gonna have to use it with this group. Naturally, if it gets to the point where violence starts to occur, we'd rather resort to tasers than nightsticks, you know, and because we don't want to hurt anybody. A taser is just something that'll stun you and say, oops, I don't think I want to mess with this guy.
He's got a broken hand! What is he doing?
Trying to stop us. We want fair trade! We want fair trade! Special ops got him. The ninja!
The ninja!
Set him free!
The ninja!
He belongs to
us. Okay, we'll take it.
He belongs to the people!
Next time it doesn't get sent back, okay?
Okay, we'll try in another section.
Okay, good luck.
Beauty Nation!
Are you ready to let them know how we feel about FTAA? Are you ready to tell Bush that we don't want any FTAA? On behalf of the AFL-CIO and the Industrial Union Council and all of its affiliates, I want to thank the Alliance for Retired Americans for helping us mobilize for all of our activities here this week. And when we defeat FTAA, and we will defeat FTAA, it'll be because current workers and retired workers came together in solidarity and sent a loud, clear message to the leaders of 34 countries that are assembled here. No FTAA, not now, not next week, not next month. God bless you, brothers and sisters. Keep on fighting.
Yeah. You know what I woke up to this morning? I woke up to the sound of helicopters. Let me tell you, they can stop our buses and they can try to keep our people out. They can harass us with more cops than we can ever believe. They can try to stop our people from getting in. But they sure as hell can't stop our movement for social and economic justice for the workers of the Americas. Sisters and brothers, this is a fight not just for economic justice, but clearly from what you can see in the streets of Miami today, this is a fight about whether or not we'll have democracy if we have an FTAA. Let me tell you that today, just a few hours ago, steelworker retirees trying to get into this auditorium, trying to get into this amphitheater, were thrown to the ground. A woman by the name of Sherry Hogan, the wife of one of our members, was made to lay on her face in the pavement, and they put a gun to her head and told her not to move. They can do whatever they want with the goddamn guns, but they will not stop our movement. They will not stop us from getting the justice that we deserve. We just stick that gun right up his ass.
Hey, we ready to march? Can't hear you. We ready to march? The problem is we got a little traffic jam, so don't get up too quickly. Are you ready to march?
Job to another man.
my wages in some foreign land. And when I asked, how could that be any good for our economy? I was told nobody cares so long as they make money when they sell their shares. Can you hear us? Are you listening? No power without accountability. Job, my car, my house. Went 10,000 miles away. Some guy clicked on a mouse. He didn't know me. We never spoke. He didn't ask my opinion or canvas my votes. I guess it's true. Nobody cares till those petrol bombs come spinning through the air. Gotta find a way to hold them to account before they find a way to snuff our voices out. Can you hear us? Are you listening? No power without accountability.
From Local 201 of the IUECWA in Lynn, Massachusetts. I represent workers at a factory in Wilmington, Massachusetts that's been directly affected by NAFTA. 3 years ago, the company gave us a transfer of work notice, a six-month transfer of work notice to move work to Reynosa, Mexico. That work is taking about half of my workforce out of the factory and is exploiting workers down in Reynosa at $6 a day wages. They're firing young women in the factory as soon as they learn that they're pregnant. And as a matter of fact, we recently learned over the past few months that the workers there were too expensive for our corporation, and they're moving the Mexico work to Shanghai, China. People in this country, of course, are fighting for their jobs, you know, and when they find out that their jobs are being given to people that are being further exploited, that really pisses them off. You know, that just really pisses them off. And we're looking for fair trade, you know, not free trade the way they have it set up now, you know.
Free trade sucks! Free trade sucks! Free trade sucks! Free trade sucks! It sucks! It sucks! It sucks like shit!
Remains peaceful, you will be allowed to demonstrate. Yeah. If there's any violence, the demonstration will end immediately. Once again, as long as the demonstration is peaceful, you will be allowed to demonstrate. Once there is violence, the demonstration will end immediately. Once again, as long as the demonstration is peaceful, you will be allowed to demonstrate. If there is violence, the demonstration will end immediately. Thank you.
The police are the only people here who've been violent.
Why did they do that? I don't know.
Yeah.
Fire. Ooh.
Idealistic college students, but we were intimidated and made fearful of coming here, not by the protesters, but by the police. Let me tell you, these college kids never walked up to a kid playing a video game and blew his head off the way these police officers did.
Thank you. don't see yourself on the news.
I'll never see myself on the news because I'm dressed in a suit. I'm what someone would perceive as an ordinary American, small business class, middle-aged person. So the national media will never cover those of us who are out here.
Once again, here a live look at some of the demonstrators that are arriving here, that are staying within that compound. Now, throughout the day today, we have seen vehicles pulling off, vehicles leaving. The demonstrators make the point here that they will not be violent. And in fact, all they want to do is go down there and have their voice heard. But they do also make the point they believe the media is an arm of the government, that the FTAA will also cause problems for the media. As you can see over here, we actually have one of the protesters, one of the demonstrators, who's even filming our live shot right now, saying he wants to make sure there is fair coverage.
The media is an arm of the government.
Embedded with the police.
Violent protesters.
Wartime level propaganda.
Black.
Independent media.
Move back. You can move right behind this line right here. Right here.
You take all the pictures right you want, just back up over here, okay?
Okay. Right here.
What's going on here?
Right here.
Can you tell us
what's
going on
here?
Please don't push. You can't. You're pushing my camera, man.
Sir, if you get up on me again, we're going to have to.
This is, we're press here.
Move
you. What's your badge number, sir?
Beg your pardon?
Sir, what's your badge number?
Don't have a badge.
You're required by law to give us your name or your badge number.
By law? What is this? You think this is the Army? Sir, I'm going to tell you again.
I've never seen the kind of wartime level propaganda that people are getting on their news today. They decided to have embedded journalists with the police, which is of course a tactic, you know, page out of the propaganda book in Iraq. The media is further embedded in this whole process with the fact that the Miami Herald is on the welcoming committee.
The Miami Herald Publishing Company supported the FTAA with editorials, $217,000 worth of free advertising, and $67,000 in donations to subsidize the summit. The FTAA would remove barriers to media consolidation and facilitate U.S. media companies like the Miami Herald expanding their operations across the hemisphere. Numerous media watchdog groups have called for the exclusion of media from the FTAA.
Right now, the FTAA hasn't even passed, and already we're living privatization in our media outlets in Mexico, for example. Just a week ago, Fox passed this sort of bill or resolution to try and privatize the Mexican National Movies Association. So that would mean that there won't be any school for Mexicans to learn how to do cinema. Currently, the government is just looking out for business interests. So with all these regulations and laws that free trade is going to bring, then that would just kill our media.
Utilizing the latest Pentagon tactics, Police Chief Timoney invited the press to embed with his forces. Corporate media, including the Miami Herald, embedded 24 reporters each day.
Why did you come with the police and not just
Because we're embedded with them. Embedded means like just like it was in Iraq. You're embedded with the police, so that means that you're assigned to a patrolman or a group of patrolmen, and you're right along with them, and you cover what they're doing. And
are they giving you a tour of what's going on?
I'm a photographer of the sunset.
And where did you get the helmet?
I think we had to rent it or buy a used one, because in order to ride with the police for the period of time I was assigned to, you had to have a gas mask and a helmet.
And is this the first time you've worn a helmet and a gas mask?
Yeah.
And are you calling yourself an embedded reporter, or is that just?
Yeah, I mean that's true. So yeah.
Are the police more forthcoming with information? Do you feel like,
I mean,
now that you have
point,
this status?
I mean, they're letting us know, you know, what we're getting into, and like.
5 minutes we're doing this, next 5 minutes we're doing that.
Whose idea was it, do you think? You don't know?
Probably, you know, I mean, somebody came up with it during the war and it's been passed on.
Are you guys embedded?
No, we're just on the street.
You're not embedded reporters?
No, they would be
with the police?
But why do you have police gear on?
So we don't get our heads caved in by police batons.
What media are you guys with?
NBC News.
What do you guys think of what's going on today?
It's pretty interesting.
Interesting?
It's nice to see free speech in action.
Yeah. Why did you choose not to be embedded?
Well, actually, I wasn't asked to be embedded. I don't have anything problem with people being embedded, but they ought to be embedded on both sides.
Police made it clear that they would not guarantee the safety of unembedded reporters. Anna Nogueira, a reporter from the nationally syndicated radio program Democracy Now!, was pepper sprayed and arrested. The Miami New Times Celeste Fraser Delgado was arrested and her camera left in the street. Commercial filmmaker and local businessman Carl Kesser came downtown to make a film for FTAA delegates, profiling what he expected to be Miami police's professionalism and restraint. He was hit by a police beanbag round while standing on the sidewalk and is still partially paralyzed.
A lot of people gave us an account of the police who had been in the neighborhood earlier through the day that had encouraged people to rob kids as they came through. When we got to First Ave, some guy jumped out from around the corner. He had a friend with him, and he pulled a knife on my camera operator. And then his friend grabbed the tripod. They dragged the camera down the street.
They told us to rob y'all. Police told us to beat the ass, rob them. Whatever y'all take from them, do it, but we said no. Why should we rob the police? Man, see, look on the cameras.
The cops came with the boot camp like shit with all the gear on and shit. They came and they say the person with the blue hats on or whatever, they're the ones with the money to bond you guys out. So just rob them and take the money and shit. I'm like, rob them and take the money. We ain't going to jail. Say nah, just beat their ass. They don't want y'all down here.
Did you hear anything about police incitement?
Everybody knows about it. That's just the way it goes. You know what I mean? So, yeah, we all heard about it.
You heard about what?
Basically that, you know, if anything goes down, we don't see it.
I filmed several examples of police brutality, serious excessive force. I turn around, I start walking away. I get less than a block away, and I feel a 9mm gun. I told me to drop my camera, take off my camera case, lay down on my stomach, empty my pockets. And there were a million police around. Everything that I shot that day was in that case or in my pockets and was all robbed.
We're on top of the situation. We have our reporters in downtown Miami, embedded with the police.
It was this, the show of force that quickly put an end to any problems. You want proof? Here's video Thursday night. Suspected anarchist after suspected anarchist headed to jail.
They went to great lengths to try to disrupt things, but police kept the peace.
Black bloc anarchists were the ones who got out of hand.
You need a general who is in charge of the troops.
But you actually got hit here, right?
Yeah, I got hurt. Hit everywhere while they were throwing rocks at us.
Show me where you got hit.
Right here.
And this was by a rock?
Mm-hmm. A piece of cinder.
Police show us what they had to put up with. rioters with gas masks, bolts, slingshots, manuals detailing their plans.
That lady there, I'm sure she has a lot to say about the FTAA, and unfortunately from up here, we can't hear what she's saying.
Look at this image. The sea of officers in riot gear time and time again. A wall with no fear. A wall that kept the streets safe, even in the face of sometimes violent protesters. Even this officer standing with a shield full of paint, they stood strong, strong to maintain the safety.
The trouble began around 9. CBS 4 News was the only station with live pictures when the scuffles broke out and the began flying. A massive show of police force in full riot gear used batons to hold back violent protesters. Violent protesters. Violent protesters.
From your vantage point, what's going on?
Well, from my vantage point, everything is perfectly clear, courtesy of the police.
As the trade ministers were preparing for their meetings this morning at the Intercontinental Hotel, few of them knew or even cared about what was happening in the streets. They've seen it all before.
We who need to know, and it's basically we're provided for the safety of those protesters who come here to peacefully protest.
During the earlier demonstration here of those union workers, they said that they were disgusted by those few protesters out here on Biscayne Boulevard throwing objects at police officers.
My photographer and I were walking, trying to get to our live truck, when we got caught in a standoff between police and protesters. You can see here, this is from the perspective of the protesters. They are throwing things. Now, this is a picture of our live truck. When we got here, our truck operator was, I don't want to say under attack, but he was surrounded by a group of protesters who slashed one of our tires and wrote the word propaganda on our truck with a magic marker. And we were usually closer to the police lines than the protester lines because we didn't want to get hit with anything that was coming at us.
But I must tell you, it was really without great incident. The police were there. They were very professional, very controlled, very well restrained. I would say it was more of the same professionalism we've seen all week.
Well, this one! Oh, that one right here! Put it on your website! Fuck you!
I think we have a model here. I think we have a model here. I think we have a model here for the rest of the world to really emulate for the future when they have these sort of events take place.
This is not over, not for the people who were protesting in the streets, and not for the city of Miami. Because of the excessive use of force and because of an almost unprecedented violation of people's right to free speech, free assembly, and freedom from the illegal search and seizure, this level of violence scars a city, makes its people afraid of expressing themselves, and will more than likely end up in civil lawsuits against the city and the county. Police Chief Timoney has it out for people who disagree with the government. We've already gotten reports of a lot of people who've come out of jail with their charges dropped after their bond hearing, which also goes to show that they were arrested in the first place on an absolutely baseless charge, mostly having to just suffer through violence and harassment and being last night all in jail.
Let us be clear. The neoliberalist policies like the FTAA cannot exist without this kind of military police buildup. They trample workers' rights. They trample the environment. They trample communities of color. They trample each and every one of us. They cannot exist without this police state.
Let them go! 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 Take off that stupid gear! There ain't no riot here! Take off that stupid gear! There ain't no riot here! Take off that stupid gear! There ain't no riot here! Take off that stupid gear! There ain't no riot here! Take off that stupid gear! There ain't no riot here! Take off that stupid gear!
Here's what's happening, okay? We've got a lot of video and a lot of information that a lot of people have gone into the state attorney's office, empty garbage cans, and rocks have been piled, urine, things like that have been stockpiled in your group. based on that information, okay, we're going to have to ask you guys to shut down, okay?
Can you give us 20 minutes?
I can't, not at this time.
How much can you give us?
I can give you 3 minutes to make the announcement.
Where are they?
And they will let us disperse. Make up your mind. We might be more help to our friends outside of jail than in it with them. But that's what they said. Please disperse. If you choose to disperse, very calmly. Let's give them an example.
We're here engaging in constitutionally protected free speech. We have 150 friends in jail for free speech, and we're unwilling at this point to back down. And we believe the Miami police are breaking our laws by if they arrest us.
Media, please move back. We're going to make an arrest. We're asking you to please move east. Get us about 20 feet, please. Media, please move to the east. To the east.
Backwards, facing the riot cops with peace signs up, chanting, put your weapons down.
Put your weapons down!
Put your weapons down! Put your weapons down! Put your weapons down!
We were about 100 people in the street, and the riot cops stopped.
Put your weapons down! Put your weapons down! Put your weapons down! Put your weapons down! Put your weapons down!
They gave us an order to disperse again, and they told us that we had 2 minutes to get out of the street. And those were the words that they used.
Put your weapons down! Put your weapons down!
I am Lieutenant Jeff Finnick here in the Miami-Dade Police Department. Under Florida State statute, I hereby declare this non-lawful assembly. If you do not leave, you will be arrested. Chapter 870.04 states anyone remaining at an unlawful assembly will be arrested.
So everyone says, well, what do you do when you get out of the street? You go onto the sidewalk, right? So 100 people step onto the sidewalk, and in less than 1 minute of those 2 minutes that we had to disperse, the line of riot cops that had been crossing the street turned and curled around about 40 of the 100 people. Pushed us up against a chain link fence, and just came in, just started pushing in. And they yelled for people to get down on the ground, and we did that. And they just came forward with their shields and batons and pepper spray and just attacked people.
Surrounded us, tackled us. I was dragged by my hair. Thrown onto the ground on my stomach. I had a policeman kneeling on my back and something in my face. I could hear everyone around me screaming because there was pepper spray being put directly into their eyes.
I got down on the ground and covered my head and my arms. This police officer pulled my arms off my head, had a pepper spray canister, rested it up against my face and sprayed it directly in my eyes.
I saw people who had pepper spray underneath their contact lenses and they were in agony.
I was pepper sprayed, I was hit by a rubber bullet, and I was put in the back of a paddy wagon. The paddy wagon was a metal box that had no air ventilation going into it. It was a hot afternoon, so we were in a metal box filled with pepper spray with no ventilation.
So we get to the processing center and we were taken out of the paddy wagon one at a time. They take me out and they're changing my cuffs that were too tight. They cut off my cuffs and they're going to put new ones on, and six officers are holding me down, bent over with my head down. By that point, I had been attacked twice and I was really, really severely upset and hyperventilating. They thought it was because of the pepper spray, so they took me to the decontamination area where they washed me off in a shower and then took me inside of a tent where four male officers in hazardous materials suits, full white suits with gas masks on, four male officers surrounded me, and while I was hyperventilating, coughing, doubled over, couldn't breathe, and couldn't stand on an injured ankle, cut my clothing off with scissors, cut both of my shirts off. I look down, I'm not wearing a shirt anymore. I have no idea what happened. I can't breathe.
Included in the arrestees were members of the press who had been standing there, and they were labeled and identified as press members. They were arrested and taken away. It's an abomination, I think, what's happening here, and it's completely illegitimate.
4 years have passed since the victory won in the streets of Seattle.
Today, it has become apparent that the U.S. wing of the counter-globalization movement has come to a critical point in its evolution. Those who converged in Miami were witnesses to the new overarching presence of the police state, designed to crush activists dedicated to change.
$8.5 million from the $87 billion allotted for an imperialist war was used to nurture the domestic police state in the name of homeland security.
So here we go.
Many of us who have never been exposed to this level of state repression, the sense of disbelief and powerlessness is overwhelming.
This scarring experience has triggered a variety of reactions from the activist community. Some advocate the only response to such extreme police violence is to take a moral high ground and act in complete nonviolence.
That this can be the only form of civil disobedience with the potential to win in the streets and in the media by creating a poignant visual representation of state violence.
To which police officials reply over and over, they'd rather display the force than use it.
To others, Miami has shown that self-defense and fighting back is less a personal choice and more of a necessity.
Corporate media will not broadcast its own demise. For many, the immediate threat posed to the earth requires unprecedented urgency.
When peaceful gatherings that are not in accordance with the state agenda are met with an arsenal of bullets, concussion grenades, chemical weapons, and thousands of volts injected into one's body. How do we respond?
Unconditional promises of nonviolence can be disempowering and defy the natural reflex for self-defense.
Similarly, calls for engaging the police at any opportunity without a clear assessment of the conditions can be dangerous to activists willing to partake in direct action.
Is clandestine action alienating and doomed to fail, or a necessity?
How do we advance in the face of such dilemmas? Our greatest weapon is our creativity. It is worth more than the limiting choice between laying down in the streets and initiating a battle we cannot win. Now is the time for us, rather than the state, to determine the conditions of the battle. Our revolution might explode in the streets, but will die out fast if the fuel for the fire is not present deep within the cracks of capitalism.
We have not had this many white folks in Overtown since the Klan rode through in 31. Listen, if no one else has said this to you, then let me be the first. Welcome to Miami. Welcome to Miami. This is known as the Overtown community. This is Miami's oldest black community, established in 1896, when the city of Miami was founded. And all the black folks that lived around in what became the city of Miami had to move here and then could not leave here after dark. Same as apartheid in South Africa in those days. So this was Miami's most oppressed community. It remains the poorest community in Miami, and it has still devastating effects from urbanization. This expressway you see here, and there's another one running north and south, destroyed this community. But this is I-395. It takes basically white people from east to west across the community. They don't look down. They don't even have to look at black people. This was one of the scars left on this community by the highway transportation system. It's one of two interstates that crisscrossed this community.
We had volumes built on the corner. You had the theater. You had restaurants, pops and moms restaurants, and all that around here at one time. Furniture store over there on the corner. We had a men's store down the street. We had a whole bunch of stuff over here. I mean, you know, we didn't really have to go downtown for too many things at that time. But jobs was plentiful then. Now jobs done got scarce. Jobs just scarce.
In Miami and the city of Overtown, you see a lot of poverty.
I went looking for a job at this place, you know, and minimum wage is $5.15 an hour or $5.25, whatever it is. And this place is paying $5 an hour, you know, they ain't got no jobs, you know. And when you do get a job, you know, they don't want to pay you what you're supposed to get paid.
One of the biggest problems here in Overtown, Miami, is the drugs. You know, just like I say, if they want to put a cap on the drugs, they got to stop it, because it's like the people that's coming from different places are coming over here getting the drugs. You follow what I'm saying? And it's the poorest part of the city. And that don't make no sense. You would think that if you really want to get drugs, go to Miami Beach or go to Broward or somewhere. But why over in Overtown, Miami, where all the people are suffering already?
I was one of those who had the welfare taken away 3 years ago. $198 a month wasn't enough for three people to take care of two kids and bills.
I mean, it's sad. I mean,
the crime rate's so high.
I lost my job and I went to get help to get food stamps. They didn't want to give it to me because I didn't have no kids. And I told them, well, I'm hungry. They told me, well, we can't help you.
Oh, I'm sorry. I can't do this. The middle class people, I can't help you. Old Cubans, we can't help you no more. I'm so sorry with this. I'm sorry for letting you down.
And a lot of guys, you can't even blame it on the drug dealer, because some of those guys feel like they can't even get a job. So the best thing that they look at, I can sell drugs.
I hear stories all the time about how good Overtown was. I used to be so proud to be in Overtown. Now, you'll hear everybody say, Thomas for life. I say it too, because I was born and raised, and I believe, you know, that we can get better. I used to go to Dorsey Park, and we used to throw like rocks and stuff in the water back there. We just thought it was a dirty lake. Turns out it was Rinker's runoff water.
See it, where you have to like, get on your tiptoes or something, like it's right down that way.
You can see the lake.
You can see it, the creek or lake, whatever it was. You can see it. We used to always just throw stuff in it, you know?
Tarmac and Rinker, which are the operators of these two cement plants over here, both have interests or potential interests in South America. And in preparation for the FTAA protest, we did research into the companies and found that they were very pro-FTAA and are hoping that these agreements are going to come to be so that they can increase their interests. They want to open up the ports, they want to open up their transportation ways, they want to get public dollars to do that business, they want access to mining down there. And in addition, Tico, which is also right across the street, they are actually one of the interests building the natural gas pipeline that just pretty much caused the revolution in Bolivia. So it's very interesting to see how, you know, here they are in Overtown, you know, dumping on the community and making people sick. And then at the same time, they're doing the same thing in South America. And it really ties in when people here say, why do we care about the FTAA? This is why we care.
We planted everything over there from giddy up. The sod on the side of the expressway, I think it was probably like over 50 pallets of sod. Just going up the land grass all through. We had to bring the dirt, we had to bring the grass. We had to actually take the water up there because at the time we didn't have sprinklers, so it was hard work.
What you're looking at used to be just two huge vacant lots owned by the city. We started planting here without asking permission. They probably would have said no. Now we have hundreds and hundreds of plants out here, and another 2 or 3 months, we're producing a winter crop for the community.
Most of the trees that we planted, the smaller trees. And that's a good thing for the community, also, really.
What was here before?
It used to be apartment complexes. They tore them down, so it did something with the land, which is a good thing. Yeah, it's food and scenery. So you can pretty much, you can't go wrong.
Take your shovels, because you're going to need those where you're going.
Right.
The point is shovels. Right this way, right where they're
going. We wanted to do permaculture demonstrations and garden work in Miami during the FTA. So we spent a lot of time looking for spaces, and we somehow got in touch with Dr. Dunn. We talked to him to see if there was any way we could help out with his gardens, and like if he needed rainwater catchment or, I don't know, any sort of system. And he was like, what do you have in mind? And we told him about some of our plans, and he was like, sounds like you need a whole lot to yourselves. And so he said that we could do whatever we want, basically, with this lot and that lot.
Out every place. They're right across the street there. What were they expecting from you guys? Right?
Right.
Well, thank you for being here, and we love you. Thank you so much.
America right now?
What's that?
What do you want to say to America right now?
Fuck this shit. What the fuck is this bullshit? Have you ever seen anything like this before?
Absolutely not.
Not in my fucking city. This is fucking ridiculous. $8 million it cost them to fucking be out here. $8 million. Where could that money have gone? Something way better than this, that's for fucking sure.
Why they're trying to gain power, you got people that's in poverty. You follow what I'm saying? And it's all the people that's living in the upper echelon of society are getting rich, while the other people that's, you know, middle class and the poor are just suffering more and more and more.
I'll talk to you another time.
More and more. It's because of power. This guy got something to say. I gotta go check.